Good morning and welcome to our service today, and happy Father's Day. Borada akriso, sila tadai hapis. So I've just got a couple of notices for today. The collection for Reverend Gordon Cresswell's leaving gift will be in the hall. So if you want to contribute to that, do so please after the service. We will be having tea, coffee, biscuits, refreshments after the service. So you're all very welcome to come and join us. It'd be lovely to see everybody and have a chat afterwards. So this week we don't have St. James's Kitchen, is that correct? So not this Wednesday, but Wednesday week. We just have a few minutes of silence before our service. A couple of verses from Psalm 66. Shout with joy to God, all the earth. Sing to the glory of his name. Offer him glory and praise. Amen. It's Reverend Bethany today. I'll move it to her.
Thank you, Anne. So today is our Easter offering service, which I will explain more about in just a moment. So hopefully everyone has the order of service. Feels very fancy to have real bulletins today. So let us begin this time of worship with our call to worship. And these words come from Proverbs 31. Strength and dignity are her clothing, and she laughs at the time to come. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and the teaching of kindness is on her tongue. So let us rise as we are able to sing our first hymn, number 251 in Singing the Faith, Jesus Christ is Waiting.
Thank you.
Amen. Welcome to this Easter offering service. This year's theme, Tell Her Story, Tell Our Story, is about stories of women who have been forgotten or overlooked. They are stories of courage, compassion, and calls for change. The theme has been inspired by the 10th anniversary of Methodist Women in Britain, and the work it has done to empower and enable women around the world. During this act of worship, we shall dedicate the Easter offering, which you have envelopes, hopefully, all of which goes to the World Mission Fund of the Methodist Church in Britain. As we listen to and reflect on the stories of women from around the world and through time, we will consider how we can share our story, our sisters' stories, and God's story with the world. Let us rise as we are able and sing number 707 in Singing the Faith, Make Me a Channel of Your Peace. Let us be together in a spirit of prayer. Almighty God, how amazing you are. Your transforming love inspires us to be more welcoming. Your creative touch invites us to be more inquisitive. Your passion for justice engages us in the fight for a better world. Your unending grace strengthens us in our walk through life. And we continue to pray. Lord God, today we approach you with grateful hearts as we pray for the women of the world. We are thankful for the amazing women in our lives, mothers, sisters, aunts, grandmothers, and friends, and all who have touched and enriched us. Thank you for their gifts and talents, and their nurturing and supporting presence. We are thankful for those throughout history who have fought for the rights of women and those marginalized by society. While the battle for equality and justice is not over, we thank you for the difference they have made to our lives, our communities, and our world. We are thankful for the women who are working for change today, the campaigners, politicians, survivors, and trailblazers, who work tirelessly and speak out courageously on behalf of women all over the world. Thank you for their energy, their passion, and their belief in change. We are thankful for organizations who champion the voice of women. Today, we thank you especially for Methodist Women in Britain, Magnify, Restored, and All We Can. As we celebrate the 10th anniversary of Methodist Women in Britain, we thank you for all those who have been part of the women's movement in the church. Finally, Lord, we are thankful for your radical message of justice and peace for all, for showing us that your kingdom is built by all, for all. We are grateful for your example and pray for strength and courage to follow your way of radical inclusion and love. So throughout this service, we're going to share stories of three different organizations that are working for that peace and justice that God calls us to. So this first story is about an organization called Magnify You. Magnify You is a project started in South Africa by a Methodist mission partner, Jane Day. The aim of the project is to empower women to be strong, powerful people and fulfill their full potential by being more themselves. Magnify blends different professional techniques to cut through old hurts, current barriers, and future stumbling blocks. The project focuses on encouraging three things in its participants: finding the courage that everyone has within them, finding creative solutions for being unable to move forward in life, and finding new habits and new thinking which change life for the better. To do this, Magnify You provides coaching, retreats, and courses to women from a variety of backgrounds. To date, over 200 women have attended the Magnify Leadership Program. The coaching and courses help participants to use their experience and their journey to celebrate who they have become, and to inspire and lead others in their communities and churches. The retreats offer space for women to recharge, reset, and re-engage with their spiritual life. This beautiful quote from the American author, political activist, and spiritual leader, Mariana Williamson, gets to the heart of what Magnify You aims to instill in each woman who takes part. We were born to make manifest the glory of God that is within us. It is not just in some of us, it is in everyone. And as we let our own light shine, we unconsciously give other people permission to do the same. As we are liberated from our own fear, our presence automatically liberates. Magnify You aims to unlock the potential of every woman they work with, and not just accept who they are, but celebrate the journey that has formed them. So now we are about to have our first reading from Scripture, and the first reading today is the Magnificat, of which the name Magnify You relates well to the Magnificat. This is the song of praise and manifesto for change that Mary sings when she visits Elizabeth after hearing from the angel that she is to give birth to the Son of God. So I invite Anne Langford forward to read the Magnificat for us today.
Mary's song. And Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Saviour, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the mighty one has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, just as he promised our ancestors."
Thank you, Anne. The Magnificat is Mary's story of praise, her praise to God and telling God's story about what he has done for her and what he will do for our world through Jesus Christ. So you can see in your service sheet that we have an activity here called Telling God's Story. So for this brief activity, I want to encourage you to think about the gospel story and the life of Jesus. And they're telling us that we should try to pinpoint one aspect of the gospel that we would like to share with a friend or family member or someone we know who isn't a Christian. What aspect of God's story do we most want to shout about and tell people about? I invite you to take a few moments to just think about that. If you have the service sheet and something to write with, maybe you can write down the words that you think of. But pinpoint one aspect of the gospel that you most want to share with. Now I'm going to ask for any brave volunteers. Is there anyone willing to shout out? What is it about the story of God that you want to share with people? Love. That's a good one. The Good Samaritan. If you're going to pick one story from the gospel, that's a great one to tell. She said how Jesus reached out to those that society rejected and showed them his love. Ooh, I love that. He died, but it wasn't the end. If you remember my Easter sermon, that's exactly what it was, that word "but" that changed everything. Wonderful. So want us to keep that in mind as we go through this service. Again, it's telling her story, telling our story, telling God's story. So those are the most important aspects of God's story that we want to share, that he died, but it wasn't over, that God's love is for absolutely everything. So let us pray. Loving God, we place all these amazing stories in your hands. And we thank you for the inspiration they give us every day. Give us the strength to share them and your message of all-consuming love and never-ending hope. Our next hymn is number 618, Sacred the Body God Has Created. She's going to play it through one whole time, and then we'll sing the second time so we can catch the tune. Let us pray together now a prayer of confession. And there will be words in yellow where I invite you to join me. Gracious God, while we celebrate these amazing women, we are aware that we have not always treated all your children with the respect and love they deserve. Forgiving God, we are sorry for our neglect. We confess that we have not always believed women, being quick to judge and slow to care. We have questioned their stories, motives, and fears without taking time to listen and show compassion. And in doing so, have alienated those who need us most. Forgiving God, we are sorry for our disbelief. We confess that we have not told the stories of women, leaving them out of history and undermining their achievements and their pain. We have turned away from the complex stories and given in to patriarchal narratives even when reading the Bible. Forgiving God, we are sorry for our selective storytelling. We confess that we have not built a society that is always safe for women. We have allowed the sins of sexism, misogyny, and racism to prevail, leaving all women vulnerable to attack, abuse, and harassment. We have put the onus on them to protect themselves rather than challenging society's sins. Forgiving God, we are sorry for not challenging society's sins. We confess that we have not reflected your gospel message in the way we have treated women in the church. We have at times made them feel small, ignored their gifts, and silenced their stories. We have not always followed the example of your son who empowered women to share your message. Forgiving God, we are sorry for not living out your gospel. God, we have sinned against you and against those you love, in thought, word, and deed. We seek your forgiveness and help to challenge the sins of society and build a world that is fair and safe for all. Wash away our wrongdoing and renew us through Jesus Christ, your Son. Amen. And let us pray together as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Story two for this morning is called Restored. Restored is changing the story for women who are caught in the cycle of abuse by supporting survivors, advocating on their behalf, and engaging men in the conversation. Since 2010, Restored has been dreaming of a world in which churches do not tolerate abuse, but instead provide a safe refuge for survivors, nurture them back to health, and demonstrate God's deep love for them. Abuse robs men, women, and children of their identity, security, and value. Those working at Restored want to give it back. The Survivors Network sits at the heart of all they do. It provides a crucial safe space in which women who have been subjected to abuse can support each other within a community that understands and that will cheer them on as they enter a new season of hope. Those at Restored say that it's a privilege to journey with some amazing, brave ladies who are on the journey to recovery. It's their hope that every survivor of domestic abuse will know their inherent value and that they are loved by God. So here is a quote from a survivor who has worked with this organization. She said, "Restored not only changed my story, but changed my life. I have felt God's love through every email and every post I have read on Facebook. When I thought I had no one who could understand my story, I found Restored, and I began to feel hope and could dream of a better future. Thank you so much for all the work you do and for all the love you give each day." Amplifying the voices of survivors has never been more important. The network has been growing for the last 5 years, but in the last year, due in part to the pressures of lockdown, that growth has exploded. In 2020, the network grew by 89% in just 12 months. Lockdown has exacerbated abuse, but for some women, it has felt like lockdown for a very long time. Here's another quote from a survivor who has worked with this organization. "Reading things on the Survivors Network has been like going outside and feeling the fresh breeze after years of being stuck inside. It has given me strength when I didn't know how to go on, and the courage to continue making a new life for my children and I, free and safe." This organization is working not only to support survivors, but to stop this abuse from happening in the first place. They will continue to be there, supporting women on the journey to freedom and helping churches to journey alongside them for as long as it takes. So our next hymn is number 693, Beauty for Brokenness.
Thank you.
The next reading from 2 Samuel is the story of Rizpah. If you remember in the prayer of confession, it said that there were stories that we haven't always told from even the Bible. And this is one of those stories that is rarely read. It is the story of Rizpah, who was one of Saul's concubines. When David killed Saul and his heirs, she made a courageous stand, showing that in both life and death, all should be treated with dignity and respect. I invite Richard Bond forward to read us this story, and it will be from the Message translation.
There's some quite complicated names in this. I'll do my best. But the king selected Armoni and Mephibosheth, the two sons that Rizpah, daughter of Aiah, had born to Saul, plus the five sons that Saul's daughter Merab had born to Adriel, son of Barzillai, the Mephibosheth. He turned them over to the Gibeonites, who hanged them on the mountain before God. All seven died together. Harvest was just getting underway, the beginning of the barley harvest, when they were executed. Rizpah, daughter of Aiah, took rough burlap and spread it out for herself on a rock from the beginning of the harvest until the heavy rain started. She kept birds and away from the bodies by day and wild animals by night. David was told what she had done. This Rizpah, daughter of Aiah, and concubine of Saul. He then went and got the remains of Saul and Jonathan, his son, from the leaders at Jabesh Gilead, who had rescued them from the town square at Beth Shan when the Philistines had hung them after striking them down at Gilboa. He gathered up their remains and brought them together with the dead bodies of the seven who had just been hanged. The bodies were taken back to the land of Benjamin and given a decent burial in the tomb of Kish, Saul's father. They did everything that the king had ordered to be done. That cleared up things from then on. God responded to Israel's prayer for Israel, for the land.
Amen. You can see why that story isn't always one that we read in scripture. There's a lot of courage in Rizpah to cry out for justice, even after harm has been done. So you'll see in our service sheet, we have activity 2 now, telling her story. And for this, they want us to reflect on some of the stories that we have heard during the service. The stories of Rizpah, the story of Mary, the stories of women who have been served by the organizations we have talked about. And they also want us to think about the injustices that we have seen in the world. And to think about, we are going to tell her story, the stories of women we know who have been overlooked or harmed, women who have faced injustice and oppression. Take a few moments to think about the stories that we have heard this day and ones that you have seen in your life. When we leave this service today, I want you to keep those stories in your heart and to think about how you can tell those stories, or how you can find organizations to work with that are helping to tell those stories, and even more importantly, to change those stories, ones that are better for the world. So let us pray. Loving and gracious God, we pray that you would give us the courage to tell the stories of people whose stories are often going untold, where we have power and voices that will be heard. Give us the strength to lift up those who do not have power and are often overlooked or unheard. As we seek to follow Jesus Christ, Show us the way that he would care for the people in our midst, who are often overlooked. Pray this in his name. So then we come to story three, which is about an organization that is familiar to most of us, All We Can. And here's the story they are telling us this week. Teenage mothers in Uganda are rewriting their stories. Rural Uganda is not an easy place in which to be a young mother, something Jacqueline has learned firsthand. She was just 17 years old when she gave birth to her daughter. Abandoned by her child's father and rejected by her own family, Jacqueline and her infant daughter faced incredible difficulty and struggled to make ends meet. Young mothers like Jacqueline can face alienation, discrimination, and stigma in their local communities. After giving birth, Jacqueline was unable to find work, leaving her unable to provide the basic necessities for her daughter. Where many mothers might bask in the joy of their newborn baby, Jacqueline was left destitute. I had nothing to put on my baby's body. I could not afford anything, she said. I realized my future had come to an end. Young mothers like Jacqueline in rural Uganda are amongst some of the country's most marginalized women. They often lack the knowledge and support they need to be able to make informed choices about their reproductive health and their futures. This can lead to a vicious cycle of early pregnancy and limited opportunities, leaving young women and their children trapped in a relentless cycle of poverty. All We Can's local partner works with mothers like Jacqueline, often young women who have been raped, cast aside, and alienated from their family and wider society. This local partner helps them rewrite the narrative of their life story and take control of their future. Through livelihood training, small business startup kits, and lessons in life skills, All We Can's local partners in the region tackle these challenges head on. And here's a quote from Sarah, the director of All We Can's local partner in Uganda, responsible for this transformative program. She said, "We find these girls when they are hopeless. They share their stories with tears running down their cheeks. Now, today, we can share with them, and they can afford a smile. They feel confident that at the end of their course, they will be able to make small businesses which support them and their children." All We Can supports women who find themselves alone and unsupported. Through training, care, and love, they find hope again and are once again able to fulfill their potential. What a beautiful story of the way these organizations are working with women, not to just give them what they need, but to give them the resources that they need to provide for themselves and for their children. And now we will have our final reading for this service. The final reading is one of the final chapters in the book of Esther. Esther is the queen, having been chosen to marry the king after the exile of his previous wife, who had disobeyed him. In this reading, she is confronting Haman, who is planning to kill the Jews, and she confronts him in front of the king. I invite Anne Lincoln Ford to read for us from Esther.
So the king and Haman went to dine with Queen Esther, and as they were drinking wine on that second day, the king again asked, "Queen Esther, what is your petition? It will be given you. What is your request? Even up to half the kingdom, it will be granted." Then Queen Esther answered, "If I have found favor with you, O king, and if it pleases your majesty, grant me my life. That is my petition. And spare my people. This is my request. For I and my people have been sold for destruction and slaughter and annihilation. If we had merely been sold as male and female slaves, I would have kept quiet.
because no such distress would justify disturbing the king. King Xerxes asked Queen Esther, "Who is he? Where is the man who has dared to do such a thing?" Esther said, "The adversary and enemy is this vile Haman." Then Haman was terrified before the king and queen. The king got up in a rage, left his wine, and went out into the palace gardens. But Haman, realizing that the king had already decided his fate, stayed behind to beg Queen Esther for his life.
Another story in scripture of a courageous woman standing up for people who are being harmed. Now we come to the activity titled Telling Our Story. So here again, I invite you to a time of reflection. I invite you to reflect on your own journey of faith, the struggles you may have faced, the joy that you have experienced, and the day-to-day life that fits somewhere in between. When has Jesus walked beside you? When have you felt at peace? When did you accept the love of God into your life? And then I invite you to think about which of these moments or stories that you would like to share with others. So let us take a few moments to sit and think about our own story, of our own faith and experience in God. I'm sure this is something we could all sit and reflect on for quite a long time. But hopefully this is just the start of you reflecting on your own story with God, and you will find ways to share that story with other people. I do want to give an option if anyone is feeling especially called to come up now and to share their story about God.
I'm here today because of a couple of women. The first, my grandmother, Madge, a woman of faith, a suffragette. My daughter always votes because my gran said to her, "Always vote. My friends died for your vote." And she went on then to work for Mary Stopes, the organisation providing contraceptive advice to women. And she was a Tory councillor. So I don't know what she'd make of me being a Welsh Labour councillor, but I'm sure we could have some interesting discussions. She always had my back when I was growing up. And she lived to her 90s. And the second is my mum, of course. And it's strange that it's Father's Day, but we're talking so much about women. But I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for my mum in not just the reproductive way, but also the fact that every Sunday she took us to church. And so it became part of the pattern of my life. And she still goes to church. She walks around the corner because she can't drive anymore. But then she is 90, so. And that's really, it's the love of those two women that bring me here and effectively keep me here.
Thank you for sharing that, David. Does anyone else feel called to come and share their own story
of faith. Well, hopefully when we share in some fellowship time after the service, if you're talking one-on-one with people, it might be a bit easier to share those stories. I too, like David, have a story of a few women in my life without whom I would not be here and would not have the same faith that I do. And I think I've shared my Paul story before, but in particular, there was one minister in my life when I was in high school named Pam Deeds. And she was the first one to ever say to me that she thought I had a call to ministry. And I thought she was crazy. But it was because of that conversation that we had once when I was about 15, 16 years old, that a few years later, I ended up going to seminary, and then now I'm here. And that is just one of the ways that I have seen God and the Spirit work in my life through other people. And those conversations that we have with people are so important, because so much of faith is about stories. The stories that we find in Scripture and the stories that we have experienced in our own life. One of my favorite Christian authors is Rachel Held Evans. She sadly passed away a few years ago on Easter at a very young age. She was only in her 40s. She was a prolific writer before that. And one of my favorite quotes from her, she said that as Christians, we don't all have to believe the same thing. But what we do is that we are gathered around the story of Jesus Christ. And it is that story that brings us here, and that story that keeps us together, and that story that keeps us trying to walk in faith. So even when there are things that we may disagree on, may we always remember that it is the story and the person and the love of Jesus Christ that brings us together. Let us be now in a time of prayer. And these prayers of intercession are in your service sheets, and they'll be on the screen. So please join me when the words are in yellow. Compassionate God, we pray for the victims of gender-based violence and abuse all over the world. Help hold all women who feel trapped, unsafe, and who live in fear in your loving arms. We pray for a world where every person can feel safe, secure, loved, and cherished. Caring God, we pray for those who have escaped violence and abuse. Be with them as they rebuild their lives and make your love and presence known. Lord, give them the courage and strength to take the next steps. Creator God, we pray for projects that are changing women's lives. While the work is hard, we pray that these project leaders feel your encouragement and empowerment in everything they do. We pray for their success, expansion, and creativity in meeting the needs of women where they are. Passionate God, we pray for female leaders around the world, for the trailblazers and freedom fighters, fearless women who are paving the way for the next generation. We pray that you sustain their passion for change and give them the energy to keep going, no matter what gets in their way. Encouraging God, we pray for those who come alongside women, supporting them, encouraging them, speaking out for them, and giving them space. Lord, give more people the strength to stand up for what is right and speak truth to power. Enabling God, we pray for Methodist women in Britain as it celebrates its 10-year anniversary. We pray for its leaders and members as they continue to engage in creative spirituality, fundraising, challenging injustice, and supporting women around the world. Gracious God, in this time of quiet, we bring before you all the women we have spoken about today, all those who have touched our lives, and all those who have made a change in the world. as we lift these women up to God. Lord, remind them that they are loved and admired in all that they do. Loving God, who knows all our prayers, hold all those who inspire and care for us now and always. Our next hymn is number 702, I Will Speak Out. And this one we decided was a little bit tricky to try and learn to sing. So we have a YouTube video of it. So I think the words will be on the screen. And if you want to try and sing along, go ahead. Otherwise, this is a good one to just sit and listen to the words as a time of reflection. Today there is a place to give to the church, and then you have these envelopes if you would like to give to the Easter offering. So let us pray a dedication for the offering today. Creator God, we ask you to bless this money and those who have given it. May these gifts for the World Mission Fund be used wisely to enable the love of Jesus to be made known throughout the world. In Jesus' name we pray. And our final hymn is one that has become one of my favorites since coming here to the UK. I never came across this one in the US. But it's number 615 in Singing the Faith, Let Love Be Real.
Thank you.
May God bless the trailblazers, the change makers, the leaders, the allies, and all of us with courage, compassion, and the vision of a fairer world for all. Amen. And let us say the words of the grace to each other. May the love, I always forget how it goes. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of our Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen. Amen. And now you know why I usually write everything on my tablet. Amen. And please do join us for fellowship after the service. Thank you.